Joining me now is Alan Dershowitz, professor emeritus at Harvard Law School and author of Trumped Up, How the Criminalization of Political Differences Endangers Democracy. Professor Dershowitz, welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
Now, there's a lot in the ether here about what the president may or may not do with Robert Mueller, with Rod Rosenstein. You obviously just spent a lot of time with the president in the last 24 hours. I know it was mostly about Middle East politics, but let me ask you this. Why are you so convinced he is not going to fire Mueller or Rosenstein?
Well, because I think it would not be in his interest, it would not be in the interest of the country to do that. I think there's a big distinction between Mueller on the one hand, who he definitely shouldn't fire, and Rosenstein. I think it might be appropriate, and I've said this before, to make a motion to recuse Rosenstein from any involvement in the obstruction of justice investigation that concerns the firing of Comey, because he's a witness. He wrote the memo, and the first witness that any good lawyer for President Trump would call would be Rod Rosenstein. Didn't you write the memo? Did you think you were obstructing justice when you wrote the memo? Would you ever help a president obstruct justice by giving him a justification for firing Comey? I don't see how you can be both a prosecutor and a witness at the same time.
So you think on that narrow aspect of this investigation of supervising Mueller that Rod Rosenstein should recuse himself, and you think somebody's going to make him? I mean, who would ask him to do that? Is there a formal way that would be done?
Well, he should recuse himself, number one. Number two, of course, President Trump and his lawyers would have the legal ability to make a motion for him to recuse himself or to make a motion later if he participated in any way in a process that was adverse to the interests of President Trump. But there's a big difference between firing somebody, which he might have a constitutional right to arrange. He might have to do it indirectly.
Right.
But making a legal motion to recuse, which is something that every potential subject of an investigation has the right to do.
Now, you told Slate that your advice to the president would be don't fire, don't pardon, don't tweet, and don't testify.
Right.
As you know, the president doesn't take some of that advice. He obviously doesn't take the advice on tweeting. And we know many members of his legal team have asked him not to say certain things, and he says them anyway. When you have a client that doesn't take your advice, how long do you keep that client?
Well, most of my clients over time have refused to take some of my advice. They're independent people. It's their liberty that's at stake. It's a very rare case that a lawyer would resign from a case because the client wouldn't take his advice. I want to be clear. I did not give the president any legal advice. I never give legal advice to anybody unless I am their lawyer, and my legal advice is subject to client confidentiality. By the way, client confidentiality suffered a big blow the other day when the lawyer for Donald Trump's home and office were raided, and they took all of his material and just put it in front of a taint team, which means FBI agents and low-ranking Department of Justice people get to read the confidential material and then say, but we're not going to give it to the prosecutor. That's not a good enough protection.
Well, let me ask you about that. I know you were highly critical of that, but there is a much higher bar to do something like that at the Justice Department than it is to just go and seize records of just an average citizen, a non-lawyer. The fact that it went through the Southern District of New York, the fact that it went through a federal judge, the fact that it went through Rod Rosenstein, does that not make you say to yourself, well, there may be something there. They must have had some evidence or some concern that Michael Cohen wouldn't comply with a simple subpoena?
It's possible, and that would maybe justify searching records of Michael Cohen, although you could subpoena a lot of that stuff through bank records and other things. But what justification is there for then seizing client information, lawyer-client privileges, information of the client, and then giving that to FBI agents to read? Remember, the Fourth and Sixth Amendments are different than the Fifth Amendment. The Fifth Amendment just says you can't use it in a criminal case,
right.
So taint teams work. The Fourth and Sixth Amendment says you shouldn't read it. Imagine if this weren't lawyer-client privilege material, but a confession to a priest or medical confidential information or confidential information to a wife.
What if they have evidence that the lawyer participated in the crime?
Well, that would be enough to subpoena material from the lawyer, but not material that affected adversely the client. And you should always use rate of a lawyer's office as an absolute last resort. And I don't see this as a last resort. And you should only use it for very serious crimes. Apparently, they're investigating Stormy Daniels. I just don't think that rises to the level of when you should raid a lawyer's office. I think those are usually used for mafia cases, organized crime cases, terrorist cases, major corporate fraud cases. It's unfamiliar to me to have a lawyer's office raided because of payments to a porn star, even for potential violations of election laws or potential violations of banking regulations. Those alleged crimes don't seem sufficient to justify the extraordinary act of raiding a lawyer's office and reading lawyer-client material that might very well be covered by confidentiality, despite the fact that there are some exceptions.
The last time you and I spoke, you were not a fan of having him speak to Robert Mueller unless under, you know, some sort of negotiated circumstance. Do you feel strongly about that today?
Even more strongly, because they were in the process of negotiating and cooperating, and now you find a nuclear option used by the other side. So it seems to me negotiations haven't paid off very well. Look, no person who is a subject of an investigation should ever voluntarily speak to the prosecutor. Prosecutors aren't there to help you. They're there to get you to hurt yourself. He may have to make a negotiated appearance because otherwise he could be subpoenaed in front of a grand jury. But if he has the choice not to talk at all, of course, any subject would be advised by his client to exercise that choice not to testify.
Does the president have enough people on his legal team? Does he have a strong enough legal team in your view?
You know, nobody ever has a strong enough legal team. I think the president has some very, very good lawyers on his team. I know Jay Sokolow, who's a terrific lawyer. I've argued against him. I've debated against him. Ty Cobb is a very, very good lawyer. He lost a very good lawyer in John Dowd. But I think he has a good legal team. He could always improve the team. He may need new lawyers now that there's an open investigation in the Southern District of New York. He may need New York lawyers on his team as well.
And is he ever going to find a former practicing lawyer like yourself to join the team, Professor Dershowitz? I asked you last time.
I want to remain independent. I like the role I'm playing. I think I'm helping to educate the American public about civil liberties. The absence of a voice by the ACLU and other liberal forces, you know, the only good thing that's happened here is that conservatives have finally understood how important it is to be civil libertarians at the same time that liberals are forgetting about civil liberties and just trying to be partisan advocates for getting Trump. So we've seen hypocrisy on both sides, and I think it's more important than ever for me to stand as a supporter of civil liberties of all, whether I agree with them or voted for them or not.
Professor Dershowitz, I will leave it there. As always, sir, thank you for coming on and sharing your views. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.